Hello, everyone joining us in the virtual space. I'm Walter, and this is a seminar on Chrome extensions. So Chrome extensions are great lightweight tools that people use to personalize, customize their web browsing experience, make it more efficient, make it more enjoyable. And they are actually easier than you might think starting out. At their most basic level, they're a single manifest file in JavaScript object notation, a JSON file. And there is a lot of complication that you could add here. Hold on. But you don't have to. The only things that are actually required for a Chrome extension are the manifest version number, a name for it, and a version number. If that was all you had, your extension wouldn't do anything. It wouldn't be very exciting. But you don't have to do much more than that to get something working. So as a very, very basic example, we've got a piece of code here. Which just has a manifest.json with a name, a description, a version number, manifest version number. So note the name, the version, and the manifest number are the three things that are critical. And we have an icon, which is what's going to show up in the top right-hand corner, the badge for the extension. Crest.png is just the Harvard crest, a picture that I found on the internet. And there's a browser action. I'll talk more about that in a few minutes. But note that it has a pop-up, and that's going to be an HTML page. The HTML page itself is very simple. It's literally just some text, which means it's not going to be very interesting, but it'll serve as an example. And if we want to see that in action, we'll need to pull Chrome back up. And we're going to look at back at our extensions page. You'll note I'll unenable these for the moment. So these are the extensions that I currently have installed that are not examples. But if we want to enable this example, you'll note that we got one more popping up here with the Harvard crest, as I said. And if we click on that, we should see that HTML page. Note, it's not very pretty. It's very plain. It's not formatted well. But you could fix that yourself with some CSS and some more complicated HTML. But that's a working Chrome extension. And it was maybe 15 lines of code at most. Now, for more information about a manifest file, this URL, which will also be in the slides, has a full listing of things. And you'll notice you can click on most of these different fields to learn more about them. There's a lot of stuff there. There's a lot of functionality that you could take advantage of, but you probably don't want to or need to. But there will be something to accomplish just about anything you could want within the context of this manifest file. So we've now got a couple of different ways to actually implement your Chrome extension depending on what you want it to do. So the first of these is a browser action. And that was what we saw in that other example where we had the pop-up. Browser action, the goal of a browser action is to have some action available anytime, regardless of what web page you're on, anytime you, say, click on the badge up at the top, or maybe anytime you type something specific into the Chrome search bar. They're going to be around all the time. Now, something that might not be what we're looking for in a Chrome extension. Maybe we want something that specifically interacts with Facebook in a specific way. And in that case, a page action makes much more sense. because its functionality will be localized to one or two or three pages, it only needs to run when those pages are currently loaded, which allows us to save processing resources. The way it'll look slightly different, it won't have the same badge, but it will be able to have the same functionality in terms of when you click on it, or you'll be able to affect things the same way that you would with a browser action, just only for specific pages. A third idea to be aware of, it's not in the same category as a browser action or a page action. Either one of those can have a background script, but a background script is a JavaScript file. And remember, JavaScript we're using primarily to affect the DOM. It will be running all the time in the background, as the name suggests. So if there's some functionality, say maybe you're creating a Chrome extension for an email account, and you want a notification anytime an email comes in, that script is going to need to run all the time because an email could come in at any time. So background script would be the right choice there. You can also create background pages. Sometimes in terms of structuring your application, it might make more sense to have an HTML page where the JavaScript is being run. But the main thing to focus on is the scripts, the JavaScript scripts. Additionally, event pages and event scripts are similar to background scripts. They can run all the time in the background, but they wait until a specific event has happened, which makes them a little bit less wasteful. So this is what Chrome is asking people to do these days, unless there's something that really should be running absolutely all the time. Now, additionally, content scripts are something else. They're not, certainly if you have a background script, you can also have a content script, but there's sort of ideas in opposition. Because they're running very much in the foreground. They are directly interacting with the pages that you, as a user of the extension, are viewing, really changing the DOM directly. And they can, you know, if you have an application that has both, they can communicate through message passing. This is something that Chrome has constructed. That's a more advanced topic. I'd suggest you check out the documentation for that. But just know that it does exist. And content scripts, we have an example of. So remember, we said that content scripts were good at changing the DOM. Pull that up. So we've got another, that's not quite the right one. We've got another manifest. Same kind of deal, name, version, description. But we also have this content scripts tag, and I should actually tab this over for good style. But we have this content scripts field here, which has several parts inside of it. And note also that we have square brackets here, so content scripts implies there can be more than one. And within this single script that I'm running, it has more fields. So matches is telling us which URLs this content script should run on. Here it's just saying anything. JavaScript, the JS, that's the script that's going to be run, and we'll take a look at that in a second. And then run at is saying when these scripts should actually be run, and here we're choosing to run them at document end, which is to say when the document is fully loaded. So if we look at this content.js file, it's not important that you understand everything that's going on here, but essentially we're pulling out all of the elements of the DOM. We're iterating through each of them. And when we see the word psychology, we replace it with applied biology. When we see it with biology, we replace it with applied chemistry. You could, if you wanted to, substitute in plenty of other words here. It's just a simple model for how you could use a content script. And to see that in action, no, that's not quite what we want. So remember I said psychology will be changed to applied biology, and we're going to need to enable that extension word replacer. In this new tab, we're going to go to the psychology page. And you'll note it got changed after the page was fully loaded to Applied Biology. And we'll see that it ended up getting changed everywhere here. Now we have Applied Biology. So that's content scripts. Page override is another cool piece of functionality that Chrome gives you. Chrome has a few default pages, the one that handles your history, your bookmarks manager, and the new tab page that comes up. And a Chrome extension can override one of these with its own HTML pages, adding some functionality or anything else you find interesting. So I've created a simple example here, which just replaces your background, the background of a new tab page with some additional nice pictures. Again, this manifest looks awfully similar to what we've been seeing before. That's because you have to have the same default fields every time. I'm using the same icon, that could be changed. But note the new field here, Chrome URL overrides. So that field is saying we're going to have an override page in this extension. Which one? New tab. And we're going to override it with menu.html. Menu.html is a very simple file. I've just listed some things that you could do in the new tab space instead of the picture that I'm including. But then it also loads in a CSS file. And that CSS file will load in into the body, the background of the body, this background.jpg, which I've also pulled from the internet, and then just does a little bit of formatting to make the text that I've put there look nicer. But so if we go back to our extension page and enable that one, pretty pictures. So note again, something, we had the crest pop up here, but I can't click on it. I didn't have a page action or a browser action here. So clicking on it wouldn't do anything. Chrome grays it out automatically. But if I go over and create a new tab, we have a beautiful picture that is obviously not the default page that we would see here. So just another idea of things you could do. For additional functionality, and this is where Chrome extensions really start to gain power. You know, most of the things that I just showed don't have much substance to them. But if you want to really start affecting the way that Chrome works and, you know, changing the browser, Chrome offers a vast selection of APIs that will allow you to make these changes. Whether it's to, you know, windows or tabs, you can open, close, search through, manipulate those things, or you know, changing things in the Omnibox, which is the search box that Chrome provides. Chrome storage is really useful for storing user preferences, which can be really handy. Notifications will allow you to send users notifications in their desktop from Chrome. So there's a lot of really cool stuff in there. We can't go through all of it because there's just too much, but there is a listing of this at Chrome's documentation under API index. One thing to note is that also, you know, to do some of these things, you're going to need to like to ask for which URLs users have open, because that's a privacy risk for Google and for your extension, I suppose. You have to get explicit permission from a user to be able to do that. That's actually very easy, though, because in the manifest, there is a permissions field in which you just specify the list of permissions that you want, and it'll prompt users to accept those permissions when they download the application. So that's handled for you. Finally, I mentioned something about user preferences earlier. One nice thing that Chrome offers is an already partially set up options page. Again, you create your own HTML files here. You can link them up to the rest of your extension with, you know, basic JavaScript. And it will, the options UI especially, will create a nice overlay to the extensions page, allowing you to change the options as a user. So Chrome extensions overall are a very powerful tool. Let's just go back to the start. Very powerful, but at the same time, lightweight tool. And keep that in mind. You know, most people, when they're looking to install a Chrome extension, don't want another full application. The whole idea is that it's an extension, so while it might have a lot of functionality, it shouldn't be, you know, it shouldn't be a hog of memory, processing time, and maybe it shouldn't even have that much functionality. Maybe one or two things is a good amount of stuff to encapsulate into one Chrome extension. And if you have more ideas, maybe make several. Let's see, do we have any questions?
Could you speak to the publishing a little bit?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So publishing is, you know, it's super important. Obviously, if you want, I haven't mentioned yet how you run your own Chrome extensions. So I'll need to pull this over again. Right, so you can have those, you know, your files with the Chrome extensions on your own machine. Once, if you go to this extensions page, the URL up there, if you check the developer mode box, you will get this load unpacked extension button, which brings up a window if I click on it. And this is where I've stored my Chrome extensions. So if I wanted to load one of these, you'll note if we look back, if you look back in the video at where the manifest file is stored, it's at the top level of each of these folders. That's how Chrome knows that it's a Chrome extension that it's loading in. But I can just open one of these, you know, hit OK, and it will load a local copy of the extension for me. So if you wanted to share it with a few friends, you could take those files, turn them into a zip, send it through email or Facebook, and then they could unzip it and upload it in the same way and use it. So currently, you know, I've been enjoying this new tab picture functionality, so I'm going to keep using it locally probably. But if you wanted people beyond those who have communication with you to be able to use your extension, you're going to need to bring it to the Chrome Web Store, which is designed to do this. Let's see. And you're going to go through the developer dashboard, for which you'll need to have a Google account for this. And I'm not actually going to sign in right now, but it allows you to upload extensions. And then after paying a fee of $5, I think, to have your account activated for publishing to the web store, you can upload things and other people will be able to search for them and download them themselves, which is pretty powerful. They will, and extensions get vetted for, you know, for viruses and such. So, you know, I guess don't try to pull anything because Google's always watching. But you should be able to get that published, I think, pretty easily once you've gotten past that first step. I think that's all I have for now. Thank you for watching.